year, continue to have this growth period, so we teach those who are lost. We have Brother Patrick again, at least the class tonight, that we can attend. The spirit of pain with the Bible, like I was saying, for the families, let's say that.
Alright, so before we start in chapter 12, I kind of wanted to review a little bit. We might remember that all of Daniel, these were God's chosen people, and they were led into captivity for a reason. What was the reason why they were led into captivity? What had they done? They turned their backs on God, right? They strayed away from what he had commanded them to do. So they were being punished. And there were very, very few that were actually still being obedient to God. Daniel being one of them. His three friends being a few as well. Their Babylonian names as we know them by, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. So very, very few were still being obedient. They were trained and raised up. And they were being given wisdom by God in all of this. Yes, they were trained by the Babylonian like soothsayers and wise men, but they were given wisdom by God so that as they were being trained up in this, they were they weren't going to be brainwashed into that, but they were going to be trained up in Babylonian knowledge, so to speak. And Daniel is working for these rulers for many years. In fact, he even had the opportunity to go back to Jerusalem, but he chose to stay. And when Cyrus takes over, he decides he's going to stay and work with Cyrus. And so Daniel remains in this captivity. He chooses. He realizes, and I mean, God kind of has a place for him, and he knows that. But he is continuing in this captivity, working for God while he's working for these rulers. So God has his hand in this captive place and also back in Jerusalem all at the same time. And we can kind of see that when we go back into our study next. But in all of this, why we're seeing all the jumping around is because Daniel is getting these visions at different times while he's in this captivity. He's getting them while he's under Nebuchadnezzar. He's getting them while he's under Belshazzar. I'm going to get the names right because Belshazzar is Daniel's name. Belshazzar, which is Nebuchadnezzar's son. And then he's also getting them while he's under Darius and Cyrus and all these other rulers. And all of these angels are coming to him and interpreting these dreams and visions for him. And some of this stuff he doesn't even understand. He's not getting all of the interpretation because they're telling him, don't worry about it, right? He's getting really stressed out because a lot of this has to do with God's people and a destruction that's coming in the future. And it's bothering me. And so these angels are telling him, don't worry about it. God's got this taken care of. So that's where we get to in Daniel 12, is it's another vision of the time of the end. We're getting some more of these numbers coming up. And if you listen to at least Adam Clark, and I've got F.B. Meyer as well on here, there's some premillennialism in here with this. So we're going to ignore that kind of stuff. We'll kind of mention it just to see what they say, but that's premillennial stuff. Kyle and Delich stick to it, and I think Matthew Henry sticks to it. But we'll go ahead and begin here. Steve, could you get us the first? first five verses, if you would, please.
At that time, Michael shall stand up, the great prince who stands watch over the sons of your people, and there shall be a time of trouble, such as never was since there was a nation. Even to that time, and at the time your people shall be delivered, everyone who is found written in the book, and many of those who sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, some to shame and everlasting contempt. Those who are wise shall shine like the brightness of the pilgrim, and those who turn away to righteousness like the stars forever and ever. But you, Daniel, shut up the word and seal the book until the time of the end. Many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall increase. Then I, Daniel, looked, and there stood two others, one on this river bank and the other on another river bank.
Thank you. All right, so he's talking about this book. What type of language does this remind us of? Where else can we read about a book that has everlasting life? The book of life. And we read about that where?
Revelation.
In Revelation. Okay? And Revelation is mostly about the destruction of Jerusalem. Again, that's where I'm getting my ties from with Daniel and the destruction of Jerusalem and these prophecies. That's where a lot of this wording is coming from. We need to look at more evidence.
Verse 2.
Okay. What part there specifically?
And many of those who sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake. Some to everlasting lives, some to shame and everlasting contempt. They didn't do that in 70 AD.
Right, but we have to remember back in, was it chapter 9, I believe, this talked about the prophecy where it meets up with Jesus and what happened at Jesus' death. Weren't there some that were risen then?
Yeah, but not to everlasting lives.
True. Okay.
You're breaking your back trying to put a premillennialism. I don't believe in premillennialism, but the scripture says something. That's just the way it is.
So this can't be just the destruction of Jerusalem, is what I'm thinking. And that's what's confusing me, because they're raised to everlasting life, some to shame and everlasting contempt. And that didn't happen then. That's yet to happen.
And
right?
We'd still be walking this earth if that were true. Or wherever they're at, everlasting life.
That's where I wonder or not. How that fits it.
Right. Okay. I don't know.
That's a good answer right there. You're like me. That's the one I don't know.
You don't know me, some of it.
And that's the only time and place in the New Testament the word everlasting life mentioned. I know it's said in several.
Right.
And so that doesn't seem to me like that can go with verse 178. You know, I've tried to read which way, and I can't figure out how that goes with that. So then where it goes. See what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Anybody else?
Well, it references to John.
To John?
5:28 and 29, what Jesus is talking about. The hour is coming for all to be ready to hear his voice. Come forth those who have done good to resurrection of life, and those who have done evil to the resurrection.
Positive Matthew 25, 26, 46.
Matthew 25? Yeah.
So John 28, 29.
Matthew 25 is talking about the judgment day.
So
see, that's what the
discussion doesn't go with Jerusalem 70. Where are we headed? John 5:29, and here's the reference, and so it wouldn't go with Jerusalem 70 AD. It would go with his guarantee of receiving judgment on Jerusalem 70.
that's the end.
Yeah. So I look at the
false. You get into Revelation 22:19, it talks about the book of life.
We can keep reading and see what we get to. I don't know 100%. I know that most of the prophecies at least have dispensations as far as like the kingdoms because of the prophecy, the prophecy and the dream of Nebuchadnezzar that don't get too far into the future past Christ. Which premillennialists try to go further than that. Verse 2 could be talking about further than that.
In verse 3, you get into that. There shall shine as a brightness forever and ever.
Mm-hmm.
So that eternal. I don't understand it either, but that's just sometimes. When it says closed up and sealed, that's a pretty interesting. Shut up the words
well,
and seal.
Verse 3 does say, as the stars forever and ever. Yeah. So it's a symbol.
Yeah, but I mean, I think they're saying they'll shine like the stars forever and ever.
That means they will appear that way to others.
I think it goes back to being a light.
A light to the world?
It says they will be wise, they'll turn many to righteousness. They're
going to
be brighter than stars.
Yeah, and that's...
And those are the ones... I mean, two was talking about many of them that sleep in the dust of the earth are dead. And they shall wake, they rise again. It makes sense that it would be judgment day. Some are going to everlasting life, heaven. Some are going to shame and contempt, punishment, torment, hell.
In verse 4, it's interesting. You compare that. It says, shut up the words and seal the book, the time of the end. But then you go to Revelation 22:10. And you see these things, and John uses the phrase, seal not the saying of this prophecy, but the time is at hand. So if we take the accountability that John probably wrote that about 96 AD or something, of course, you definitely mean that that's kicking in. I mean, it says about knowledge shall be increased. I think that would probably be talking about the Christ and the apostles and all. We gained a huge amount of information from Christ and the apostles. And many shall run to and fro. That means apostates. The Jews are pretty good at that. And the knowledge shall be increased. Just throwing it out there. I mean, I don't really understand it. I'm not taking a one way or another, but really, you just have to take what it says and don't try to distort it in any way, shape, or form.
those three verses there for sure have a lot in them.
I even glanced at Kyle and David, and they go through all this stuff. Did you let Kyle and David show that?
Yeah, I've gone before.
I mean, they go through all these different theories and everything by being to study the Bible probably their whole lives. They have different opinions and views, and Kyle and David kind of moderated on the fence a little bit, what they kind of did a little on that. They had some opinions, but it was. They presented a lot of opinions down there too. Especially these last prophetic chapters started in, back earlier, 7 or 8.
Well, okay. Renata, let's get the next 5 verses here.
I might make one last comment on this. In reading Adam Clark, and I have to browse through there, and he says that in his opinion, shut up the words and seal a book, that prophecy might not be understood until it's accepted its accomplishment. You seem to make me think. And then we just have to wait until it's fulfilled, and then it would be very clear. And many times these prophecies aren't clear until they happen. Now, we depend on your negative view if this has happened or not happened.
Yeah, and the problem with Adam Clark is he's premillennial, and so he thinks this wouldn't be until later.
But he's a pretty good commentator on it, so. Yeah. I mean, there's a lot of, you know, some of this is just difficult. I'm not a premillennialist, but I don't see how it fits. But there are some verses that you just have to throw away. Christ is coming running for 1,000 years. That becomes very, very difficult, you know, and you're dragging people loose and all that. I see where they're coming from, where they can kind of get that at, so until I can explain it fully and logically, I'll just sit there because I don't believe in premillennial ideas, but I'm not going to be accused of distorting God's word either. Just take it for what it is. If I don't understand it, I don't understand it. But I don't want to lead somebody astray.
Well, that's a good point. We don't need to do that. I don't
put it out there and let them chew on it. Well, like they want, you know?
Yeah. All right, I guess we're 6 through 10.
Okay. And one said to the man clothed in linen, who was above the waters of the river, how long shall the fulfillment of these wonders be? Then I heard the man clothed in linen, who was above the water of the river, when he held up his right hand and his left hand to heaven, and swore by him who lives forever, that it shall be for a time, times, and half a time. And when the power of the holy people has been completely shattered, all these things shall be finished. Although I heard, I did not understand. Then I said, my Lord, what shall be the end of these things? And he said, go your way, Daniel, for the words are closed up and sealed to the time of the end. Many shall be purified, made white, and refined. But the wicked shall do wickedly, and none of the wicked shall understand, but the wise shall understand.
Okay, so Daniel's vision here is of two men, angels possibly, on either side of a river, and he's being spoken to here. And again, some of this wording here is a lot like what the apostles are speaking to Jesus with in Matthew 24. We have, oh my Lord, what shall be the end of these things? Let's look back at Matthew chapter 24. Because the wording here is very, very similar. And I think we need to be able to understand what the words mean. And that may be where we're getting confused in verses 1 through 5 as well. Maybe we're trying to put a spin from our perspective on it, and we don't understand from back then. So in verses 1 through 3 of Matthew 24, and Jesus went out and departed from the temple, and his disciples came to him for to show him the buildings of the temple. And Jesus said unto them, see ye not all these things? Verily I say unto you, there shall not be left here one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came unto him privately, saying, tell us, when shall these things be? And what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world? Now, if we look at the Greek for world, we would think that end of the world would be the end times, the very end. Because most of the time when we think the end of the world, we're thinking the destruction of the world. But the Greek here means the end of an age. According to the Greek language, the disciples are talking about the end of their time. We have to go back to verse 1 as well. Where are they at? They're standing in front of the temple. They're talking about this temple being crumbled and destroyed. And so they're talking about everything they know as a Jewish society, a Jewish structure being destroyed. When is going to be the end of this time? When is going to be the end of this age? That's what they're asking.
I'm going to drive you crazy with that, if you do realize that, don't you?
Go ahead.
Verse 3, to me, what he's doing, and I don't know, end of the world. I mean, okay, what's the Greek word for the end of the world, actually, where they talk the end of all, okay. Period.
That's what I'm waiting for.
Because the King James Version, I mean, they're pretty good
you want
translators.
The Greek word.
They use the end of the world when they translate it. And they're pretty good translators, those guys were. They didn't put age.
Mine says end of the age.
It is aeon, which is age.
New King James.
The Greek word is aeon.
For what?
For age.
Okay.
What's the Greek word for world?
It's aeon.
The same as age?
Yes.
What's the Greek word for what now?
The Greek word for world is age. It means it's aeon, which means age.
Okay, what's the Greek word for the end when it's folded up at the end of the world?
For end?
If it was the end times completely, like you
it's,
know,
the phrase world. End of the world is soteleion aeon, which is end of the age.
I think what he's meaning is we know that's the end of the age, but what's the Greek word for actually the end that we're talking about, the very end,
what would be the Greek word for world?
Yeah, the actual.
The word world. Okay, well, we'll have to look that up because it's not in the Bible here for a Greek. All right. Let's see.
Make your own paycheck here.
It is cosmos, which makes a lot of sense. The cosmos. There you go. So it's a completely different word, not even close. That's what they're asking, and if we keep it in context of where they're at, this location, they're in front of the temple. Jesus is talking about these stones. Not a stone is going to be left unturned. He's talking about the temple being destroyed. And so they ask, when is this going to happen? When is going to be the end of the age of our world as we know it as Jews? And so he tells them, and he goes into this whole long, I hate to use the word spiel, but that's basically what it is here, and tells them what's going to happen, and leads into this prophecy of the destruction of Jerusalem.
I was going to look there. What he's talking about, to me, you see, he told them they're going to throw that temple down one stone at a time.
Right.
And then he says, tell us when
when these things shall be.
Right.
And I think that's referencing the destruction of the temple. Then the next question is, what shall be the sign of thy coming? And then the third question is the end of the world. So when you read through here, you've got to answer three questions.
It looks like three questions, but why don't they have to be, why can't they be the same?
By coming, when that's the one that drives us in a bunch.
Hang on just a second.
Because he's already there talking to him. Is that what you're saying?
Well, if he says, of thy coming, I think, what is that? Are they talking about he's coming back to earth? Or what is that?
Hang on just a second. I got you.
Okay. No fun when you have all these references around your teacher like that. You used to really be able to stumble.
I don't have 100% here, but
that's just something to think about. We're not going to figure all this out tonight.
Yeah, the power of Jesus coming is not necessarily referring to him physically. It talks about Jesus coming in a cloud, but it's referring to his power.
The sign of thy coming.
Yeah, it can refer to his power, and it refers to that several times in Revelation. So it's not necessarily Jesus coming physically, but his power. In fact, I believe it's Matthew 16 or something. Matthew chapter 16, verse 28, referencing the kingdom. This is talking about the church. Verily I say unto you, there be some standing here which shall not taste of death till they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. This is talking about the church being established in Acts chapter 2. Did Jesus literally come back in Acts chapter 2?
Well, he came back.
When the church was established.
Before that, he came back to earth after he was dead. He resurrected, and then he came back to earth. You remember he's with him, 40 days, 40 nights or something? Thomas said, stick your finger in the wounds, you know, and all that. He did come back then.
Okay, but this is talking about the establishment of the church.
Yeah, right.
Okay, so did he physically come back
when
the church was established?
No, he didn't physically come back.
No, but his power came. And that's what it's referring to. Whenever it uses this phrase, the Son of Man coming, it doesn't necessarily mean Jesus is physically coming.
Like the Holy Spirit, is that what you're talking about? He has power.
His authority. Because it was the church was started with his authority in his name, and he has all power and authority over the church. And there's other references, like in Revelation, that refer to the Son of Man coming, or in a cloud, and things like that.
We've got to keep remember that we've got Christ, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, and they're all three God.
Right. They have the same.
So, you know,
the same power
in the order, or you know, it can. That's a pretty tough study in alone right there.
Right. We're referencing this question here, and what shall be the sign of thy coming and the end of the world? We're talking about the destruction of Jerusalem here. Why can't these questions be the same thing?
Well, I think it's clear in Matthew to me that it's destruction of Jerusalem.
Right, and the point here is that verse 15, he mentions Daniel the prophet and the abomination of desolation, and so he goes back to Daniel to make this reference.
But what stuff you still said to?
Right, and that's what I'm saying is the wording may just be like in verses 1 through 3, where it doesn't have to necessarily make sense to us because it's the English, and it's a translational thing.
Have you looked at parallel and that
gospel look like sometimes a little way to go.
13 what?
Which verse?
It's all the whole chapter, the verse he showed in the temple.
And as he went out of the temple, one of his disciples saith unto him, Master, see what manner of stones and what buildings are here. And Jesus answering said unto him, Seest thou these great buildings? There shall not be left one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. And he sat upon the Mount of Olives over against the temple, Peter and James and John, Andrew, asking him privately, Tell us when these things shall be, and what shall be the sign of when all these things shall be fulfilled. And Jesus answering them began to say, Take heed lest any man deceive you. So he doesn't ask, the same questions aren't necessarily asked here, but when shall all these things be fulfilled? So again, why couldn't they be the same questions? Referencing the same thing. Okay. All right. So that was my point, is that the wording here is very similar to Matthew 24 and Revelation, and we have to be able to take the context and put it into the time of Daniel. And yeah, it's going to be confusing to us, but we may not understand it because of the wording of how it is.
If you go down to Mark 13, you get down to verse 24 through 27, that gets into the end times, I believe, there sometime. Well,
I'd still think that's probably all the destruction.
The four winds and from the uttermost part of the earth and the uttermost part of the heaven.
Okay, what verse
are
you reading?
24 through 27. I'm not taking any people. I believe it's just a standard old deal, but I don't throw away verses either.
There's a lot of people who take Matthew 24 and split it into two parts. We can talk about that another time. We got off on Daniel here.
What about verse 30?
Verily, on Mark 13 still, verily I say unto you that this generation shall not pass till all these things be done. On Mark 13.
Don't throw that one away either.
No.
Okay, so we got down to verse 10. I would recommend that when we do get done with chapter 12, that we might go back and study this in the context of remembering that Daniel is talking about a people that were being punished. There were very few that were still faithful to God, and it's a book that's written out of time, just like Revelation, and we were not in that time. And so we need to, just like we try to say with Revelation, don't put our 21st century glasses on, do the same thing with Daniel. And try to make the wording fit and with that time period. We don't understand the Hebrew as well as we might the Greek, because we're used to studying the New Testament. But I think we need to get a little bit deeper in the Hebrew to try to understand it a little bit better. And that's, I think,
you know, difficult, right? Hebrew is a very small language. There's only about 6,000 words in the entire language, my understanding. And by this time, you've probably got it intermixed. They've got a probably taking on some of the Chaldean and everything, you know, because you've got Daniel, part of that's written in Chaldean, so I'm just making it more difficult for you.
Well, yeah, but I'm just saying, and it kind of leads into what I'm going to talk about for the invitation tonight, but we just need to make sure we get deeper in our study, and I really do like the secular stuff that we look at, and we need to do that, but when we're looking at God's Word, I know for personally, I look too much at the Greek because I understand it better. But sometimes I think we neglect the Hebrew, and we need to go try to look at it.
And the good thing about this, really, the good thing, is that we can look at it and try to find the means to discuss it. But there's nothing we can do about it anymore. There's no way we're going to lead our lives differently. There's nothing we have to do differently than we know we have to do. So that is kind of the good point about, you know, even though we may not fully understand it, there's nothing here that we got to lead our lives differently by to get to heaven.
Yeah.
It's not like baptism or some of these things that are crucial.
Right.
It's, you know, I'm not going to do anything different. I mean, because one way or the other, because I maybe don't understand this.
Yeah.
I know what I have to do.
There are some things in the Old Testament that we do need to know.
Yeah, they're very important to understand the new right. and the old and understand the new, but, you know, on that part, what we haven't understood here in Daniel, there's nothing
right. And
I'm
not
going to make your life any different. I don't know what you can do different.
I would say that Daniel is fulfilled, and it's good to go back and learn those lessons. But like I said, let's try not to neglect the Hebrew. It's a difficult one to study, but let's see if we can go back and challenge ourselves with that. Because I think we understand the Greek a little bit better.
And you get down to 13, you end up the last word at the end of days, which is not, you know, what, do you have anything on that that you're doing looking into that phrase?
Again, I think that could tie back to the end of an age, but I'd have to look back deeper at the Hebrew.
But I mean, it's a different wording than the end of the days versus the end of the world.
Right. Yeah.
Very complicated.
When you pick up with this next week, when we look at the time and the days, the numbering, that's where more of that premillennial stuff comes in. So I don't think it goes into the years and all that, because with premillennial, it goes into like we've already passed it, 1900 stuff. But
you'll have to help me out.
That's like where it starts, and then later on. Anyway, so we've got Joseph leading singing, and then Steve has the opening prayer, Charlie has the closing prayer, and I'll have the invitation. So, Joseph, what is your first song?
97. I'm going to move this here.
Might be good to be interesting if we could research, and I'll try to look at this, to see why the King James translators put that world rather than age, you know. What big version have you got, Renata?
New King James, it says age.
It says okay, they, that's the update, it's not the original.
Yeah.
Okay.
And Mark says age in the King James. So.
Okay.
All right, 97.
Among the hills of light, hear Christian soldiers rise and press the battle ere the night shall veil the glowing skies against the foe and veils below. Let all our strength be hurled. Faith is the victory we know that overcomes the world. Faith is the victory. Faith is the victory. Oh, glorious victory that overcomes the world. His banner over us is love, our sword the word of God. We tread the road the saints above with shouts of triumph trod. By faith they like a whirlwind's breath swept on o'er every field. The faith by which they conquer death is still our shining shield. Faith is the victory. Faith is the victory. Oh, glorious victory that shall know his name confessed in hell. Then onward from the hills of light, our hearts with love aflame, will vanquish all the hosts of night in Jesus' conquering name. Faith is the victory. Faith is the victory. Oh, glorious victory that overcomes the world.
You've allowed us to come here once again to study thy word, sing hymns to you, and praise your name. We thank you for the love that you have for us, for allowing us to live in a country where we can worship you without persecution. We thank you most of all, Lord, for your only begotten Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus. You died on the cross for our sins. As we go through this night, we pray that you'll be with those that are away from us, that you might God guard and protect them, lay your healing, covering, and healing hand upon those that you know need it the most. We pray, Lord, that you'll be with those that are suffering from the aftermath of the tornadoes and other lost loved ones. And we pray that you'll hear their prayers. We pray as we go through the rest of this evening that the things that we do and say will have your blessings and be in accordance to thy will. We pray that you'll forgive us of our sins, give us the strength to forgive those who sin against us. For it's in Christ's holy name that we pray. Amen.
Next song is 119. We'll do the first, second, and fourth verse.
Tempted and tried, we're often made to wonder why it should be thus all the day long, while there are all by and by, farther along.
126. I got on YouTube last night, and I won't go into everything about this, but I was looking for some videos to help me kind of with some understanding of Daniel chapter 12, and so I typed in Daniel chapter 12, comma, Church of Christ, because I wanted some Church of Christ understanding. Well, when you do that, you don't pull up videos on understanding Daniel chapter 12 from a Church of Christ perspective. You pull up videos on why I left the Church of Christ and why the Church of Christ is wrong and false doctrine of the Church of Christ. All that. So I thought, well, you know, I'll watch a video. Sure. And so there was this podcast of these three guys. They said they were Baptists. And that particular podcast just happened to be against why the Church of Christ doctrine is false doctrine or teaches false doctrine. And so they started out by describing where the Church of Christ came from. And of course, where did they start with? Cable. Alexander Campbell. And so they were calling all Church of Christers Campbellites. So they went into that, and they, of course, had a bunch of false information. It sounded like they were reading from a website that they had gotten on, instead of talking to people that they knew. And so they went through that, and then they started talking about the actual doctrine, and they got into baptism. And this is what I really want to focus on, because this is something that I'm sure... people in the church actually do probably get wrong. And it's how we study and how we teach. And this is what they were getting wrong as well. They went to Acts chapter 2 to teach about baptism. And of course they went through verse 37 and verse 36. And a lot of, not just Baptist doctrine, but a lot of denominations teach faith only. And they say that that is biblical doctrine. They are convicted by that. They say that if you teach baptism, salvation, then you're teaching false doctrine. Because they say that they're nowhere in the Bible. Can you find them? And so... They went through verse 37, and of course they were pricked in their heart, and so they say automatically they were saved because they believed. Right there, right then, they were saved because they believed. And so then they get down to verse 38. Then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. Okay, and I've heard this argument before because I've listened to a lot of debates, and most... Baptist and most other denominations will say the word for means because of the remission of sins, because you've already had your sins forgiven. And so they use this circular logic. Because they were saved in verse 37, because they had their faith, they were baptized to show that they were saved. But if we go to the Greek, which is how we need to study, we'll get to that in just a second. But what they were doing is they were reading it through the English. And how many times have we made that mistake? How many times have we heard others in the church make this mistake? And that's what I was talking about when we were talking in class. Sometimes we make this mistake when we read and we study, we just read the English. And we read through whatever version we're reading. And we just look at those words, and we understand it based on what we understand from what we learned in grammar through high school English or middle school English. And
And so they were trying to explain because of. And so they said, well, somebody goes to prison because they committed murder. They don't go to prison in order to commit murder, which is what it really is. You are baptized in order to receive the forgiveness of sins. Which, in order to understand that, you have to what? You have to go back to the Greek, which is the original language that it was written in. If we translate it into English, there's going to be some misunderstanding in the language. But we go back to the original language. Now, they are talking about something that a lot of people mess up with. And they were messing up with that themselves right there. They were not using translations like they should have. And we're talking about actual translation and not version. Okay? They didn't go back to that translation, that original language. Instead, they used English. And they made that mistake. And we've made that mistake before in the past. Many of us have. And we need to make sure that if we are studying with people, if we are teaching people, let's make sure that we use that original language so we understand what things mean when we teach. Also, we need to make sure that we're using love when we teach. Sometimes we want to make the mistake and we want to laugh, and that's what they did. I started laughing when I was watching this video, and I shouldn't have, but we laugh at people when really we should be sad. We should be saddened for their souls because they're lost. And we should want them to repent. We talked about that on Sunday morning when we talked about people that are persecuting us. We should want them, and Charlie mentioned this in his sermon Sunday evening, we should want them to repent. We shouldn't want bad for them. But we need to make sure we don't make the same mistakes that others make when we study and when we teach others. We need to make sure we know what we're teaching and what we're studying, and make sure we're doing the right thing. So when we are baptized, we know that we're being baptized in order to receive forgiveness because we haven't been saved. They even went to Paul, and of course, most people teach that Paul was saved on the road to Damascus. But he was not saved until he was baptized. This is why Ananias came to him and said, "Why tarriest thou? Arise and be baptized, calling on the name of the Lord." How do we call on the name of the Lord? We do it through obedience of the gospel. And that's when Paul was saved. Not when he was talking to Jesus on the road to Damascus. So as Christians, let's be careful to not make the same mistakes as others. Let's make sure we know what we're talking about when we study and when we teach others. This evening, if you need anything, if you need the prayers of the church, if you need to repent of a public sin, then the invitation is open to you. If you have a private sin, you can take care of that where you're at. But the invitation is open. You can come forward if you need to as we stand and as we pray.
Heart right with God over all evil.
the crimson flood, cleansed and made holy, humble and lowly, bright in the sight of God. Are all thy powers under Jesus' control? Is thy heart right with God? Does he each moment abide in thy soul? Is thy heart right with God? Is thy heart right with God? Washed in the crimson flood, cleansed and made holy, humble and lowly, right in the sight of God.
Closing song is 25. We'll do the first, second, and fourth verse of 25.
Anywhere with Jesus I can safely go. Anywhere he leads me in this world below. Anywhere without him, dearest joys would fade. Anywhere with Jesus I am not afraid. Anywhere, anywhere, fear I cannot know. Anywhere with Jesus I can safely go. Anywhere with Jesus I am not alone. Other friends may fail me, he is still my own. Though his hand may lead me over dearest ways, anywhere with Jesus is a house of praise. Anywhere, anywhere, fear I cannot know. Anywhere with Jesus I can safely go. Anywhere with Jesus I can go to sleep. When the darkening shadows round about me creep, knowing I shall wake and never more to roam. Anywhere with Jesus will be home, sweet home. Anywhere, anywhere, fear I cannot know. Anywhere with Jesus I can safely go.
Our dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for all the blessings you've given us in this world and given us these opportunities like this to look and study your word, try to learn from it, and improve ourselves to be better Christians. Sometimes we don't have all the answers, the right answers, or sometimes we just don't quite understand Scripture, but we pray that you give us knowledge to always do the right thing and live a Christian life. And what we don't understand, I'm sure that sometimes we will understand in the future. We pray that you'll be with us as we leave this building, that you'll strengthen us, and so we don't fall into wickedness and evil, and make more good judgments and everything. Use some wisdom in our lives. We pray for this country that it'll may be more godly